Simon & Schuster Audio presents Fluke, Chance, Chaos, and Why Everything We Do Matters by Brian Klaas. Read by the author.
Chapter 1. Introduction. If you could rewind your life to the very beginning and then press play, would everything turn out the same? On October 30, 1926, Mr. and Mrs. H.L. Stimson stepped off a steam train in Kyoto, Japan, and checked into room number 56 at the nearby Miyako Hotel. Once settled, they strolled through the former imperial capital, soaking up the city's autumnal explosion of color, as the Japanese maples turned crimson and the ginkgo trees burst into a golden shade of yellow, their trunks rising above a bed of lush green moss. They visited Kyoto's pristine gardens, tucked into the mudstone hills that frame the city. They marveled at its historic temples, the rich heritage of a bygone shogunate embedded in each timber. 6 days later, Mr. and Mrs. Stimson packed up, paid their bill, and left. But this was no ordinary tourist visit. The Stimson name in the ledger at the Miyako Hotel would become a historical record, a relic marking a chain of events in which one man played God, sparing 100,000 lives while condemning a similar number to death elsewhere. It was, perhaps, the most consequential sightseeing trip in human history. 19 years later, far from the Japanese maples, in the sagebrush-dotted hills of New Mexico, an unlikely group of physicists and generals gathered at a top-secret location codenamed Site Y. It was May 10, 1945, 3 days after the Nazis had surrendered. The focus now shifted to the Pacific, where a bloody war of attrition seemed to have no end in sight. However, in this remote outpost of New Mexico, the scientists and soldiers saw a potential savior, a new weapon of unimaginable destruction that they called the Gadget. No successful test had yet been carried out to demonstrate the weapon's full potential, but everyone at Site Y sensed that they were getting close. In preparation, 13 men were asked to join the Target Committee, an elite group that would decide how to introduce the gadget to the world. Which city should be destroyed? They agreed targeting Tokyo wasn't a good idea, as heavy bombing had already devastated the new capital. After weighing up the alternatives, they agreed on a target. The first bomb would be dropped on Kyoto. Kyoto was home to new wartime factories, including one that could churn out 400 aircraft engines per month. Furthermore, leveling a former capital would deal a crushing blow to Japan's morale. The target committee also noted a small but perhaps crucial point. Kyoto was an intellectual hub with an educated population, home to the prestigious Kyoto University. Those who survived would, the committee supposed, recognize that this weapon represented a new era in human history, and that the war had already been lost. The target committee agreed. Kyoto must be destroyed. The committee also agreed on three backup targets: Hiroshima, Yokohama, and Kokura. The target list was sent to President Truman. All they needed to do was wait for the bomb to be ready. The atomic age dawned on July 16, 1945, with a successful test explosion in the vast emptiness of rural New Mexico. The target committee's decisions were no longer theoretical. Military strategists consulted detailed maps of Kyoto and decided on ground zero for the explosion, the city's railway yards. The intended blast site was only half a mile away from the Miyako Hotel, where Mr. and Mrs. H.L. Stimson had stayed 2 decades earlier. On August 6, 1945, the bomb codenamed Little Boy fell from the sky not on Kyoto, but on Hiroshima, dropped from the Enola Gay. As many as 140,000 people were killed, most of them civilians. 3 days later, on August 9th, Boxcar dropped Fat Man on Nagasaki, adding roughly 80,000 casualties to the horrifying death toll. But why was Kyoto spared? And why was Nagasaki, a city that hadn't even been considered a top-tier bombing target, destroyed? Remarkably, the lives of roughly 200,000 people teetered between life and death because of a tourist couple and a cloud. By 1945, Mr. Henry L. Stimson had become America's Secretary of War, the top civilian overseeing wartime operations. As a man without a uniform, Stimson felt it was his job to develop strategic goals, not to micromanage generals on how best to achieve them. But that all changed when the target committee picked Kyoto for destruction. Stimson sprang into action. In a meeting with the head of the Manhattan Project, Stimson put his foot down. "I don't want Kyoto bombed." In a discussion with the commander of the U.S. Armed Forces, Stimson insisted that there was, quote, "one city that they must not bomb without my permission, and that was Kyoto." Yet, despite his insistence, Kyoto kept reappearing on the targeting list. It ticked all the boxes, the generals insisted. It needed to be bombed. Why, they wondered, was Stimson hellbent on protecting a nerve center of the Japanese war machine? The generals didn't know about the Miyako Hotel, the majestic Japanese maples, or the golden ginkgo trees. Stimson, unwavering, went straight to the top. He met with President Truman twice in late July 1945, each time outlining his vehement opposition to destroying Kyoto. Truman finally relented. Kyoto was taken out of consideration. The final targeting list contained four cities: Hiroshima, Kokura, Niigata, and a late addition, Nagasaki. Stimson had saved what the generals called his, quote, "pet city." The first bomb was dropped on Hiroshima instead. The second bomb was to be dropped on the city of Kokura, but as the B-29 bomber approached the city, cloud cover made it difficult to see the ground below. The clouds were unexpected. A team of Army meteorologists had predicted clear skies. The pilots circled, hoping the clouds would clear. When they didn't, the crew decided to attack a secondary target rather than risking a botched drop. As they approached Nagasaki, that city was also obscured by cloud cover. With fuel running low, they made one last pass, and the clouds parted at the last possible minute. The bomb fell at 11:02 a.m. on August 9, 1945. Nagasaki's civilians were doubly unlucky. The city was a last-minute addition to the backup targeting list, and it was leveled because of a fleeting window of poor weather over another city. If the bomber had taken off a few minutes earlier or a few minutes later, countless residents of Kokura might have been incinerated instead. To this day, the Japanese refer to Kokura's luck whenever someone unknowingly escapes from disaster. Clouds spared one city, while one couple's vacation decades earlier saved another. The story of Kyoto and Kokura poses an immediate challenge to our convenient, simplified assumptions of cause and effect following a rational, ordered progression. We like to imagine that we can understand, predict, and control the world. We want a rational explanation to make sense of the chaos of life. The world isn't supposed to be a place where hundreds of thousands of people live or die from decades-old nostalgia for one couple's pleasant vacation, or because clouds flitted across the sky at just the right moment. Children incessantly ask the most important question there is: why? And from a very young age, I, like you, learned that causes and effects follow straightforward patterns, from X to Y. It's a useful, stripped-down version of reality, with precisely one cause and one effect. It helps us navigate a more complex world, distilling everything that happens into clear-cut relationships that we can understand, then tame. Touching a hot stove causes pain. Smoking causes cancer. Clouds cause rain. But in Japan many decades ago, clouds were the immediate cause of something other than rain: mass death in one city rather than another. More peculiar still, that mass death can only be explained through the combination of a near-infinite array of arbitrary factors that had to connect together in just the right way to lead to the mushroom clouds over Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the rise of Emperor Hirohito, Einstein being born rather than somebody else, uranium being forged by geological forces millions of years earlier, countless soldiers on foreign battlefields, brilliant scientists, the Battle of Midway, on and on, until finally the devastation hinged on one pivotal vacation and one pivotal cloud. If anything about the countless preceding factors had been slightly changed, everything could have been different. Whenever we revisit the dog-eared pages within our personal histories, we've all experienced Kokura's luck, though hopefully on a less consequential scale. When we consider the what-if moments, it's obvious that arbitrary, tiny changes and seemingly random happenstance events can divert our career paths, rearrange our relationships, and transform how we see the world. To explain how we came to be who we are, we recognize pivot points that so often were out of our control. But what we ignore are the invisible pivots, the moments that we will never realize were consequential, the near misses and near hits that are unknown to us, because we have never...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.